I said I shall not hear. For of him your own righteousness I knew I will appear. May I reflect the glorious light of your redeeming grace.
Much for coming to this meeting of Walnut Creek Baptist Church. Let's go ahead and open the service up in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for your redeeming grace that has given us the opportunity to have fellowship with you and to be able to have a home in heaven, Lord, when we leave this earth. Lord, I pray that you will just bless this service. I pray that you be with pastors, they preach. I pray that you be with the children downstairs. Lord, and I pray that you will just be with the teens also. I pray that we will glorify your name. I pray that you'll be heard from tonight, and we will be ready to listen. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you very much, and you may be seated.
Amen. Very good. Glad to have all of you here this evening. And grab your prayer bulletin if you have a copy of it. And just go over a few special items we'd like to pray for. If you have a prayer request tonight you would like for us to lift up to the Lord tonight and make public, please fill out that and put it in the offering plate. I can't emphasize that. We're trying to make sure we don't miss anything. And if you could do that tonight, that would be a real help for us. We like to record these. And we've got a special prayer software we're looking at right now, maybe helping out identify some things for all of us where you can look at special prayer lists privately. Not publicly on the internet, that type of thing. We'll share more about that later. A couple things we want to make note of course, Brother Caleb will talk about this later. We have all our prayer requests on the left-hand side that we've been praying for. And on the far right-hand side, we have recent visitors, those who are sick or hurting, and general encouragement. I'd like you to look at, we've been going through different principles for prayer, and tonight we have number 9, and I think this is important. A principle, how to pray with power and purpose, pray with someone else. I just believe it helps us. to pray with someone else. I pray with my wife. I pray with other individuals in here, with the staff members occasionally. And we need to pray with someone else. Look what it says there. It's written down. Pray with someone else, though some prayers can only be said in solitude. There'll be times when you want to join hearts with another person in prayer. This is a great night to do that. And that's what we do every Wednesday night. If you commit to meeting on a regular basis, this accountability can help build consistency. Such prayer, can become beautiful, life-changing events. So I just thought we'd put that little note in there. I think that would be an encouragement to you as well. General encouragement for those who are baptized Sunday. We have some more coming up in a couple of weeks, and we have a baby dedication this Sunday. This Sunday is also what we call a big day. It's Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, and we'll be looking forward to that as well. A lot of other items we're praying for on the far left-hand side. A lot of craziness in the world going on with North Korea and talking about, you know, their bombs and Russia and China. And, you know, God needs to intervene in a lot of things. And we'll be praying for our president, our Congress, and for those that represent the United States of America, and also for those overseas as well. No doubt about that. On our missionaries tonight, of course, we have Pedro and Charles Torres. They're in Spain. Caleb will go over these later. And then Paul and Wendy Deku are in Fiji, and we have their special list as well. So that's our prayer bulletin for tonight. We'll talk about that later. We'll kind of emphasize that later on. But right now, let's stand and let's sing, of course, a great song. It reminds us of Easter. Arise, let's stand together, please. And we'll sing that, shake hands, greet each other, and then the teens can be dismissed.
And shake hands with one another. We'll allow the teenagers to be dismissed. They'll be heading next door. We'll come back again in just a moment. back to our seats. We're going to sing through that second stanza. He touched my heart and taught me love I'd never known. Verse number 2.
He touched my heart and taught me love I'd never known. He took my hand, forever making me his own. He gave me drink and living waters fill my soul. He found me lost and brought me to his home. He said, arise, and death gave way to life. He said, awake.
Seated. Very good. God bless you. And a couple of announcements. Of course, we briefly addressed these. This Sunday, obviously, is Easter Sunday, and we have a special combined Sunday school class breakfast starting at 9:15, and that'll take place downstairs. Now, we will not be serving beyond really 9:40 or so. So if you show up later than 9:30, we're going to try to cut that off. We're not going to be serving through the Sunday school hour. Of course, you can eat through the Sunday school hour. So please, if you could get here as close to 9:15 or so, that would be a help. We'll have a brief presentation. All the classes are taken care of. The adult Sunday school teachers and children Sunday school teachers will be available as well, and we look forward to that. So that's this Sunday. And then we have a child dedication service in the morning, and I'll be preaching on the resurrection in the morning service and the evening service as well. Corinthian Connections coming up on April 18th at 7 o'clock. Please sign up at the Welcome Center. You need to take care of that as soon as possible, if you can take care of that. And then our spring cleaning day, we really need as many men and ladies here as well, and that'll be on April 22nd. We've got some construction equipment here. We're going to do some yard work, and I don't care what your age is or what your abilities are, we can use you. We're going to be laying out mulch. We do this every year. And look forward to that. We have some repairs. We're going to be putting in a conduit that's going to be running some 4020 signal wiring for internet out to the pavilion, and then also some electric as well. So we're looking forward to that and getting that done. And we should have all the equipment here. And if you can help out, that would be great. I've been asked about this. I don't know how many times we've kind of decided when to do it, and trying to avoid Easter and avoid vacations, but on Sunday, April 30th, after the evening service, will be our annual dessert auction for the Wiles. We'll probably have 50 to 70 desserts, which will be auctioned off that evening. And please come, bring your checkbook, and we're excited about this. Really funds a huge portion of our Wiles camp, the portion that we have to raise, and we look forward to that. It's done in one evening, and we look forward to that on that particular day as well. All right, we'll come forward to the tithes and offerings. Appreciate your faithfulness in giving. We had a brief worker business meeting before church, went over where we stand financially. We talked about some capital improvements coming up. We'll be getting a brochure together with that, and we mentioned that at our next meeting as well, and look forward to what God is doing, no doubt about it. All right, let's ask the Lord to bless the offering this evening. And I'd like my good friend Jake Oliarchik, if you could make your way up here and pray for the offering, please.
Let's pray. Dear God, we just thank you for this day. Thank you for the privilege that we have to come together as a body of believers, just to hear from your word, and God, to talk to you, to pray, just bring our requests before you and pray together. And God, this time we just want to lift up our offerings, just what you've blessed us with. May we give some of that back, and even more importantly, may we just give ourselves back to you, God, back in service, back in worship, and it's in the name of Christ that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Very good, girls. Thank you. Let's open your Bibles, if you have them with you, to Joshua chapter number 1. We also have a pew Bible in front of you as well. We've gone through a series of messages for the last nine weeks now, I believe, on the subject of prayer. And tonight we have this message, and then I believe one more next week, and we'll wrap this series up. I think I heard one great preacher say this a while back, that all of our major problems are prayer problems. And do we lift up our requests to the Lord? Do we focus on God? And I think we all fall short of that, myself included. Well, Joshua has a great discourse here as we open this book. And, of course, Moses is leaving the scene, and the torch is being handed to Joshua. Joshua would be the man who would go out in battle. He would be a man that would go into the promised land and conquer the overwhelming majority of that for the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you look at the Old Testament, you look at the highlights, some of the great days, the days when things were going right. I mean, there's obviously some issues here, and with Achan and things like that, but these are great days. And I believe part of the reason that we find so much of God moving and working in the life in the nation of Israel was the fact of their focus on God's word and prayer. So let's stand together, please, for out of the respect of reading God's holy word. And we're going to look at Joshua chapter number 1, but I'm really going to start one verse before that, verse number 7. This is the commissioning of Joshua after the death of Moses. Verse number 7 says, "Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest." Now, I want you to look at verse number 8, because that's really what we're going to kind of unpack and look at tonight. "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt," say the next word please together, "meditate." We kind of forget that in the area of prayer. We're going to look at that tonight. "That thou meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do all according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, then thou shalt have good success." Verse number 9. "Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest." I'd like you to look in verse number 8. We're going to kind of hum in on that one word there. It says, "But thou shall meditate." I'd like to preach a message tonight on praying and meditation. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the opportunity you give us on a Wednesday night service. Oh Lord, we're needy. We come before you, offering nothing but ourselves freely to be used for your work and your will and your way. And Lord, I pray tonight as I preach this message on meditation, Lord, that you would allow us to gain spiritual truths that would encourage us and strengthen our faith as we walk in this wicked world. Guide and direct as only you can. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Meditation is a word that we sometimes in Bible preaching circles, fundamental circles, tend to stay away from because it's associated with sometimes occultic practices. It's associated with yoga, or it's associated with some type of a strange type of an event that we just don't want to talk about. But we should not be afraid of Bible words. Amen? We should not be afraid of that. And meditation is one of them. Meditation occurs throughout the scriptures. We find in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's translated from the both Greek and Aramaic into the English language. And tonight we're going to look at the subject of meditation. It's not just pondering, even though that's a part of it. To ponder, to think about, to plan. And we have gone through this series. We've talked about petitions. We've discussed many aspects of prayer. Rethinking the Lord's Prayer. We talked about that for a period of time. And tonight we're going to talk about this area of meditation, to evaluate and to ponder. So let's look at a little word study. We'll do that tonight. We have the verse I just put up there. But this book of the law, he says, shall not depart out of thy mouth. Now, we understand, if we're going to think about meditation, when you find meditation in the Bible, there's always a direct link to God's Word. So we're looking at meditation, we're going to look at God's Word and its link about how we meditate or pray in a certain way. It's like this. I don't think this is set in stone, you have to do it this way, but in my prayer life, I always read my scriptures first, I do my devotions first, and then I pray. You say, why do you do that? Because as I read the Bible, God may give me certain thoughts, precepts, concepts, or maybe even people to pray for, or maybe I should meditate on certain portions of Scripture as I pray. And think about that. For thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. Let's look at the words if we can here tonight. Number one, let's look at this word of meditate. Now let's stay in Joshua chapter 1, and I'm going to have you go to a few other places. Here, the Hebrew word that we translate means to mutter upon, or to muse, to evaluate. Now, have you ever seen somebody talking to themselves? Anybody seen that besides me? How many ever talk to yourself? You know, you don't have to worry about talking to yourself. When you need to be worried is when you start answering yourself back, right? And I sometimes, you know, I get upset. Sometimes I will talk to myself, but it's okay to meditate, to murmur, to, and maybe even verbally enunciate what you're praying about. And really, that's what part of what meditation is, to ponder, to think about, to muse, to mutter. A silent inner study, one writer said, of some spiritual manner. To slow down, to stop, to chill out, to think. Meditation. I think about that a lot as we try to run through our laundry list of prayer items, prayer list. We talked about in our series about part of what great we should include in prayer is honoring God, thinking about God, evaluating who God is, His omniscience, His omnipresence, His omnipotence, His greatness and His power. Meditate on that, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Turn to Psalm chapter 119. Let's look at some key verses here. Psalm 119. And some of I have on the screen, at least the reference there might help you out, so if we get kind of turned around. But the area of meditating. David was a user of this concept and talked about it several times. Psalm 119, look at verse number 15. As the David writes, by the way, Psalm 119 is the Hebrew acrostic, has every letter of the Hebrew alphabet broken into sections there. Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in the Bible, but is also strictly 100% written about God's Word and how we are to use God's Word. And we find in the second section of what we call this, as it breaks it up into Hebrew alphabetical letters in this acrostic, we find in verse number 15, this word shows up translated again, the word meditate. It says, I will meditate in thy precepts and have respect unto thy ways. Meditate on God's precepts and His ways. I will meditate. To bow down, as one writer said. To honor his word. Think about this. I like the practicality of a devotional life. I think sometimes we try to overcomplicate everything. We try to make everything too hard. But one of the areas I really especially support for men and women is if you're looking for a devotional life, at least include a proverb a day. Now, how many days are there generally in the month? Some months have how many? Say it. Some have 31, except February. Now, I don't know why that happened. Somehow the clock with all the planets didn't work out right or something. I don't know. I'm sure there's a way to look at that. But February always messes me up. How many of you, how would you like to be born on February 29th? You have a birthday every, 4 years, is that right, or 5 years? That would be great at my age because then I would only be, I'd be less than 20. I'd be a teenager now. Wouldn't you like to see that again? I wouldn't anyway. Oh, Lord, would I? But anyway, you read a proverb a day. So the first day, Proverbs chapter 1, you know, Proverbs chapter 2 is the second day of the month, Proverbs chapter 3, kind of gives you a way. And one of the things I really like about Proverbs, it kind of keeps a check on sin. Because it's going to cover robbery, theft, immorality, gluttony, laziness, your work ethic. I mean, you read that through for 12 months every day, I'm going to tell you, it's going to help you meditate and ponder on God's word. I used to do this years ago. I think some of you heard the story. When I was, my wife and I lived in a suburb in South Jersey outside Philadelphia. It was exactly 17 miles from the city of Philadelphia. 17 miles exactly from my house to my office. But it would take sometimes about an hour and a half to do that. Are you kidding me? And you don't under, if you're from the area, you have no idea what it's like. And Cleveland is like Mayberry RFD compared to some places. I mean, honestly, to get to a city like that, you got to go to, you know, it's traffic city. So what I would do in my car is, and these were pre-cell phone days, is I would meditate on God's word. And I would, obviously, my eyes are open, okay? I'm not driving blindfolded. But I would meditate and I would talk. And I'd often see people as they would look by me and I'm going back. Remember, these are pre-cell phone days, so you're talking on a microphone. You look like you're crazy. And have you ever seen somebody driving you think they're crazy? I have, okay? You know? But I would meditate. And part of that is I learned, now later on I learned how to do my devotions prior to getting in the car. You know, give God his time. You shouldn't waste your time like that. But the whole point is I learned to meditate very early in my Christian life on the Proverbs. And one of the things we're looking here, and we look at Psalms chapter, Psalm 119, chapter 15, chapter 1, verse number, Psalm 119, verse number 15, I'm sorry. I will meditate in thy precepts. Bowing down, respecting God's holy word. Now turn to 1 Timothy. Let's look at a New Testament application. Let's go over to 1 Timothy, if you would. And we'll look at 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse number 15. Again, kind of a similar concept. Verse number 15. Now, Paul is writing Timothy. He's giving him instruction as he will be soon turned over into the pastoral ministry. And he gives a list of what he should be doing. He talks about bodily exercise, profiteth little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having the promise of life that now is and that which is to come in verse number 8. And he goes on and on and on, and then he says something very interesting. He says in verse number 15, but meditate upon these things. Now, this is referencing, of course, his doctrine, his teaching, but God's word. Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them. Completely. And he's saying, Timothy, if you are going to get a hold of the principles that I have given you, you must, in prayer and reflection, to muse, to utter, to reflect, to bow down, to meditate on these principles. No doubt. We find so much. Occasionally, it doesn't happen a lot. My wife and I get up generally about the same time every morning. Generally. I won't say all the time. I have my special place. How many of you are traditionalists and you like have a certain place in your house you always like to sit, like the Archie Bunker chair? Anybody like, some of you know who Archie Bunker was, but I have a place I like to sit. How many of you don't even know what the Archie Bunker chair is? Some young people, okay, yeah, all right, good. That's probably not a bad thing, all right? But anyway, I have a place I like to sit. And I sit in this certain place. I mean, I sit there. And when people come in and they're new and they sit there, I kind of give them the evil eye. They don't know they're not supposed to be there. And my wife will say, don't even go there, honey. Let them sit there, all right? But I have a chair that I sit in. I face a certain direction. Remember, I'm a creature of habit, just like you are, because every one of you sit in pretty much the same place every time, you know? And even visitors, when they come, they visit every 6 months. They sit in the same place when they come back. You know, in fact, it's so funny. I went to our home church. I haven't been there in ages. And I was upset I couldn't sit in the church. I used to sit back in the pew. In the 90s, I wanted to sit in that pew. That was kind of like my pew. You know, and I hadn't been there for eight. But anyway, so I have a place that I sit and a place that I like to meditate. I like to pray. I have a certain area I flick because I can see the sun over here, the coffee, praise God's right here. And my wife, on the other hand, she likes to relax when I like to sit in a chair uptight, not uptight. I'm uptight. I like to sit in a chair, be straight, you know, my devotions here, Bible here, and I like my highlighter here, the pen here, my cheater glasses here. I got everything organized on the table, all laid out. I mean, that's just the way I am. My wife, totally different. Praise God, we're different. She likes to sit on the couch, flopping over here. This is over there. It's just it. But occasionally, here's what I find. I'll hear something in the other room, groaning. Now, she's not speaking in tongues, I promise you. And here's what happens. God did something in her devotions. And she got it. And that's what this word means. To go into God's word, to muse, to reflect, to ponder, and all of a sudden you go, oh, that's good. You ever got some out of God's word that way? And that is also included in prayer. We're missing out, bud. We're all missing out. There's jewels to be mined from God's word if we will get this concept of meditation. Now look, let's read on. It says, meditate upon these things, hold to them that thy profiting, now look at this, isn't this good? That thy profiting may appear to all. You're going to get some out of this stuff and people are going to see it. Thy profiting will appear to everybody. God working will appear to everybody if you will meditate, ponder on these things. But here's what happens. We have this list. I'm guilty of this. We'll just read through it and read through it. We'll have our Bible. We'll have our prayer list. And you know, I got this app that does this and blah, 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 blah. And then we're done. Where's God in our prayer life? Good stuff. The Greek word that is translated here could be translated to be careful, to analyze, again, to ponder. It's not just thinking good thoughts. It's not being just quiet. We receive Christ. Look here. The Holy Spirit comes and resides in us. Yes or no? And God gives the Holy Spirit. We give the Holy Spirit a chance to illuminate God's word. Remember, I'm connecting meditation to God's word, this whole message. You understand? Because if not, and I don't believe you can go down some serious doctrinal errors. But we're always finding meditation and God's word there. And I'm not saying you can't meditate on somebody who needs to be healed and somebody needs to be saved. I'm not saying that. But when we talk about scriptural processes or unpacking where this concept occurs, it always refers to God's word. Meditating, musing, reflecting. And we see here that giving attention to, I think we miss out on so much. All right, let's look at the value of it, the value of meditation. Go back to Psalm chapter 94. Psalm 94. We'll quickly look at this. I would love to tell you I got this down. I mean, I've done 9 messages on prayer, and each process, I mean, each one of them I think is important, but I think we really miss out on meditation. At least I know I do. Look at verse number 19. We look at here the value of it. I don't have this on the screen, but why don't you write down somewhere in your notes, inner peace. Inner peace. I find that in Psalm 94, verse number 19. Look at that. How many of us want inner peace, right? You dealing with something? Some of you are struggling tonight. Some of you watching are struggling. I know one person watching tonight struggling. And you want that inner peace. Look what the psalmist says in Psalm 94:19. In the multitude of my thoughts within me, thy comforts delight my soul. Inner peace. I believe meditation on God's word gives us that perfect peace. In fact, God's word says, thou shalt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon thee because he trusteth in thee. I believe that peace and comfort and contentment comes from those who spend time on meditating upon God in his word. How many of you ever had something throw you for a loop? Right? Man, where did that come from? Out of nowhere. It doesn't seem fair. It doesn't seem right. It's crazy. Back in the 90s, it was about 18 months, but 6 months pretty much full time. 18 months, I'd worked on a project trying to kill myself. And it literally was stolen by a competitor, and it was like, it just destroyed, floored me. And I remember talking to my wife and even talking to pastor, I put 18 months of my life into this thing and poof. And the only thing I had was God's word and prayer to give me comfort. Can I say this as a side note? Everybody look here. We waste so much time on stuff that has no value in the scope of eternity. We put so much time, effort, and energy into craziness. I tell my kids now, they're all, going out, they have careers and they're doing things. Some are stay-at-home moms, some of them are not. I mean, the girls, and they're working. I said, if you'll just give your priority to the Lord Jesus Christ and your family, and everything else will settle out. But if you get all frazzled about everything, trust me, I'm speaking to somebody who's been there on the other side of it. Right? And it says here, meditation, one of the values we find in meditation is inner peace. It gives us inner peace that only can come from God. I won't mention the name, but there was a dear saint that attended here when I first came to this church. She has since passed away years ago. And she would sit on that side of the auditorium, never missed a Sunday night. And she found out she had pancreatic cancer and was going to die. I never forget, as long as I went to her house, I mean, I'm crying. I mean, I'm like a basket case. And she said, Pastor Ayers, I've got peace with this. And I'm crying, her husband's crying, her kids are crying, but she had peace with it. Now, that woman knew how to pray. And she did. She wasn't sick very long, but when she died, that's where I want to go. That inner peace only comes from God. Second thing it gives us is it gives us depth of understanding. Go to Psalm 139. I think I have the proper reference there. I was kind of hurrying up to put this together, at least this part of it, the visual part of it later. But turn to Psalm 139, and I want you to look at verse 17, please. 139, verse 17. It gives us some depth and understanding. Meditation does. Psalm 139, it says there in verse 17, "How precious also are thy thoughts unto me, O God! How great is the sum of them! If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with thee." Depth of understanding. The psalmist describes himself as somebody, he says, precious of your greatness and your understanding. It gives us some depth. Psalm 1:2 says this. It says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and the law doth he meditate day and night. In fact, let's go there. Go back to Psalm chapter 1. It gives us another reference here of the word meditation, the English word meditation, as we find it in the scriptures. Turn to Psalm chapter 1, and we find that about the blessed man. Meditation. The old country preacher said it this way: stop your stinking thinking. Right? How you got stinking thinking sometimes? Start meditating. Your mind goes places. How do you wake up at night and start thinking of things that never happen? You get all anxious about it. Maybe you're not like me. Maybe you're just, you know, you're just so right with God, you go to bed, you sleep 8 hours, and nothing ever happens. I mean, I got three or four times I'm thinking this happened, that, and I got that stinking thinking. Right? By the way, do you ever notice that most of it never comes to pass? But what does come to pass is you don't sleep. Some of you are laughing. If you're older, you know what I'm talking about. Some of you younger people says, well, I have nothing going on in my life. I'm just cool. Well, wait till you get a little older, bud. You got to pay the bills, and you got to have children, and you've got crazy things going on. And you know, at our house, I'm a pastor. I understand that. You say, oh, yeah, I just found that out. Okay, yeah, I understand that. Really? Have you ever heard somebody say something really dumb? You go, really? I kind of know that, all right? But anyway, when my phone rings at night, I cringe. Because not generally, nobody calls the pastor's house at 3 in the morning to tell him they got some new insights in Scripture. Right? It's usually not good. And I cringe. I don't like that. By the way, I need to hear it. And what's really scary is when you look at the caller ID, and it's from your children. How many of you have ever had that? Scary, isn't it? You say, oh, no, what is it? Generally, it's mom, somebody's throwing up and what I do, or, you know, whatever. But you start that stinking thinking. And here's what meditation does for me. It gives me, and it should give you, inner peace. Now look what it says in Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Most of us know this. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in the law doth he meditate day and night. I got written in my Bible in pen. Turn to Joshua 1:8. That's where we started. So we got this area of meditation. It gives us depth and understanding. Now, what are some of the themes for meditation? Let's move quickly to this. Turn to Psalm chapter 62. What are some of the themes that we find woven into this idea of meditation? A theme. Let's unpack that for a minute. What are some of the themes? Psalm 62. Look what it says there in verse number 5. When we look at that, I think one of the themes we find in meditation is God Himself. God Himself. Look at Psalm 62, 5. My soul wait thou only upon God, for my expectation is from Him. In meditation, part of the themes we find is meditating upon God. By the way, this is different than waiting on God. Waiting involves loving God, where meditate involves on thinking about God or reflecting on God. Upon God Himself. Look what it says. My soul, wait thou only upon God. My expectation is from Him. How about God's work? That should say, excuse me, God's word, I'm sorry. I get to work in a minute. Turn, if you would, to Isaiah chapter 40. And most of you know this. This is a very well-known portion of Scripture. Turn to Isaiah chapter 40 real quickly. So we also meditate upon His word. Think about that. My wife were watching an old British show. Oh, it wasn't old. It was reflecting. It was back in the pre-Victorian age, sometime in, I guess, the early 1800s. And it was amazing how people would pull out the Bible, they'd read the Bible, and they were quoting verses that we knew, meditate. And you know, the same word that they used is the same word we use. Their problems are just a little different. Right? I wonder about the future. I often reflect upon that. Part of my biggest besetting sin is I probably read too much about everything other than Scripture sometimes. And I look at this whole subject where our culture's going. And with algorithms, which are basically statistical formulas that predict behavior, predict future. They said today, Apple came out today. They said they've got an algorithm written that's going to cure diabetes. They really did. They said it's going to cure it. Because the way they can do blood compounding, I don't understand all that. Now, why Apple's doing that, and I thought they made iPads. I mean, somehow they're in the medicine. I hadn't figured that one out. But that came out today. It was big news today, and their stock went through the roof, and everybody's going crazy. And they talked about robots. They said Walmart and select stores, Walmart, as of today, it has drones. You know what a drone is? A little like helicopter plane flying through the through the store, stocking shelves. And then if you have a question, a drone will say, okay, it's on aisle four, and you follow the drone and it takes you there. So I'm going, this is like nuts. I mean, really? I mean, you got this stuff. You got Amazon delivering groceries to your house. You know, things are just moving so fast, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, I'm a technology nut sometimes. I can't even keep up with it. But I will say this. That's why I'm opening to this verse of Scripture. Look what it says in Isaiah 48. The grass withereth and the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall what? Stand forever. Isaiah 48. 40:28, I'm sorry. I mean 40 verse number 8, not 28. You guys I've got it typed in wrong. Yeah, you guys are going, oh, I didn't see that. Isaiah chapter 40, verse number 8. And then actually, 28 actually works out pretty good too, but that's not where I wanted to go. Actually, that does work pretty well. Isn't that amazing? Okay, we'll get to that. That's actually pretty good. I made a mistake and got away with it. But I meant verse number 8. The grass withereth and the flower fadeth, but of word of our God shall stand forever. In other words, let's reflect on God's word. It's not going to change. Jesus said, what? I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, like, since we're going to go to verse 20, might as well go there. It's good. It talks about one of God's omniscient sovereignty. It says, hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the Creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, nor is weary? That his omniscience, omnipotence, his power, there is no searching of his understanding, his knowledge. We find all three of his attributes there. Look at it. It's great. And that's what meditation does. Now let's meditate upon his works. Turn to Psalm chapter 90. Quickly, Psalm chapter 90. Psalm chapter 90. I mean, I could go on and on. We'll wrap this up here in just a minute. But look at Psalm 90. On his works. Look at verse number 2. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. He formed the world, his works, his creation. Get up in the morning and reflect on God's goodness. And one of the handful of days we have in our particular location on the planet where the sun is out, reflect on the sun is that you see it occasionally. How many understand sarcasm? Say amen. Reflect on that. Cross-reference, that would be Deuteronomy 32, verse number 4. And lastly, our past victories. Let's close. I mean, we've got two more verses to look at. Psalm 143. And then I got a video I want to show you about something that may touch your heart. Psalm 143. Verse number 5. You know what? We've all had victories, right? Not everything's a defeat. I was sharing the people downstairs. We were talking about some capital improvements, and a number came up about what it was going to cost. And I could see, like, fog in some people's eyes. Well, that's a lot of money. And then I says, well, let me tell you about some past victories you've had here. Where God raised up 50,000 here, 40,000 here quickly to do things that needed to be done. You know, we need to remember that. Meditate on his past victories. You know, when I get discouraged, you know what I think of? I think of the time I was hit by a taxi car in Philadelphia and I thought my whole world was coming to an end. I was taking a PE exam the next day. I'd given like 2 years getting ready for this crazy test. My boss had told me I had to pass it to keep my job. That's not a big deal. Well, you go tell your wife and four kids you're going to lose your job because you couldn't pass the test. And the night before, I get T-boned by a taxi cab. Most of you heard this. If you've been here for a while, I went home and I said, I'm not studying tonight. I'm just going to pray. I prayed. I got a 71. By the way, you only need a 70 to get your license. Praise God. You say, do you want to hire an engineer that only passed by 1 point? Well, you don't know, but this one only passed by 1 point. I don't care. I got a license, and praise God. But here's the point. That's a past victory. Now, look here, that I have to go back to again and again and again, and when I get discouraged. Do you have something like that? Write it down. And see, what we find is this. Now, I want to close. Let's go to Philippians chapter 4. For the sake of time, let's just go there. This is good. Now, this is really good, especially about there is stinking thinking. And we must throw ourselves here before we close, because this really kind of sums it all up. As Paul writes in Philippians chapter 4, I think it's good stuff. As I can, Genesis, Exodus, Philippians. There it is. Okay, very good. All right, look what it says in verse number 8. I like this. Finally. You know what finally means? Okay. Listen to this. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good rapport, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, what's the next work after praise? Do you see it? What does it say? Let me say it again. Think. Ponder, reflect, meditate on these things. Stop your stinking thinking. Let's not close your Bibles. I got a video. We've been showing this the last couple, about 3 or 4 weeks, and I want to encourage you to pray for people. There's a lot of people that around the world that are dealing with persecution. Boko Raton, it's a division of ISIS. How do you pronounce it? Boko Raton, Florida. Boko Raton. Is that pronounced? Anybody know how that pronounces right? Help me out. Boko Haram. It's a radical Islamist group, primarily in North Africa, that's associated with ISIS that enslaves women, literally. It does things I could never tell you from a pulpit. And these people are in bondage as we speak. In parts of North Africa, it was a story that came out yesterday, a modern-day slavery by this group, et cetera, et cetera. This isn't on that, by the way. This is on something different. I say all that to say we need to pray for our Christian brothers and sisters that are overseas. And I think we live in such a world where we don't really like to see. We almost close our eyes about what's going on in other places of the world. I want you to watch this video, and it's, I think it's self-explanatory about praying for people. And sometimes we in a church have a hard time just getting people to show up if everything's not just right. But yeah, here's people that are suffering for their faith. I want you to watch this real quick. We got the lights off up here. Caleb, could we turn those off, please? The ones back here? They're good. All right, thank you. I think somebody's got the volume, too.
I've never prayed for the attack on my church. Six of them went to church. My dad, my mom, and the children, they are four. When we started, we sing praises. We pray for the peace of the nation. Then we pray for those persecuted Christians.
Also, nine in our family. Because during the prayer section, when the attack happened, we started hearing gunshots from the window.
My eyes was closed. I was screaming. So, by the time I opened my eyes, I saw everywhere. Like, it's fire. I was thinking that maybe so many people would die in the church.
Everybody was crying, shouting. I started feeling some pain. I was shivering. It was cold. I did not realize it was a bullet that speared through.
I saw people on the floor. Some are dead and some are crying. There's blood around them. Their bodies. People are shouting Jesus. That was the only thing I heard. Some people shouted Jesus.
My younger brother shot him on the chest. His name is Gideon. And he died at the age of 10.
I think there are 18 people that they are shot, and 12 are dead.
I saw my father bleeding seriously, both from the thigh. He's always kind. always tell us to read the Bible and be close to God. And that was the last time I saw. It's not dead. Definitely one day I'm going to meet again.
So we come to prayer request. I think where we see people that are persecuted and Christians that are dying all over the world, and they put us to shame, don't they? One little commentary I'll make about the recent incursion into Syria. And I don't want to get too political on this, but if we're going to go after every group that's persecuted, we ought to be even.